and thank you for your great leadership of the arts at the Aspen Institute. Well, it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Jeanne Gang, who is founder and principal of Studio Gang Architects. Studio Gang is a multifaceted architectural practice based in Chicago and New York. And as you'll see, her extraordinary work ranges from the intimate to the grand. On view currently at the Pitkin County Library is an exhibit that she designed called Working in America, if you want to see something locally, which features photographs by the human rights activist and artist Lindsay Addario. Jeanne is a MacArthur Fellow, Genius Award winner. and we have had a chance to collaborate in a number of projects, and it is my pleasure to introduce you.
Oh, thank you, Paula. Very Welcome. Nice to be here. Thanks, everyone, for coming. I think one of the issues we've been thinking about is this issue of stress. With climate change, economic and political problems, there seems to be a level of stress building, which I feel is making it difficult for harder for people to get along. And so what my office and my team and I have been thinking about is if the design of the environment, the design of architecture, can actually help alleviate some of this stress that we're feeling. I like to use the role of ecology or the study of ecology as a good model of a field of study that looks at the relationships between different species and their environment. And so I think it's perfect for architects because what we really need to do is not just think about individual buildings on their own, but think about how they are connected to the environment and how they can connect all of us. So I wrote this book a while back about how the city of Chicago and the waterways in Chicago could be renewed. And it was really aimed at rethinking this waterway as a future connector and gave some examples of what that could look like in the future. And then one of the findings really was the idea that even though the water quality is still pretty bad, we need to make places to connect people to this resource. And so, and only through installing this feeling of caring could we really make progress on the river quality. So we designed a project for the city. We actually did two of them. It's based on this idea of the motion of the oar in rowing. And that actually helped us define the roof geometry for the building. So all of the heating and cooling is passively done, and it's really reduced the amount of energy used, but it also created this gateway to the river. This is just a picture of it. During construction, very simple, very inexpensive. It was a public-private partnership, and a real champion of this project was the mayor of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel, to try to get kids connected to rowing and to help them succeed. So to see that many people kind of using the river, and like I said, there's still a long ways to go in terms of its quality, but it's a kind of a first step of creating this stewardship and caring about the river. And it's really a place where a lot of the different, it connects all these different neighborhoods, so it's almost like a vein running through the city that can help make these connections. The Chicago River is actually, it's a constructed version of nature. It's really a channel. And similarly, we were asked at the Lincoln Park Zoo to do something, actually they asked us to create a pavilion, an architectural pavilion. And it was located on this pond, but the pond is actually constructed nature as well, man-made version of nature that really thinks about it as a picturesque element in the city. But there were a lot of problems with this pond. It was only 3 feet deep. It had a lot of broken down edges, polluted, and really we realized that expanding the idea, instead of just thinking about the pavilion, maybe we should think about making this place a real place. So working with hydrologists and other experts, we deepened the pond to improve the water quality and used plantings to create this really intense version of urban wild. So I like to think of this as, it's part of the Lincoln Park Zoo, but it's a place where the animals come and voluntarily display themselves because the environment is so attractive. So it's a boardwalk and a pavilion that really has created a lot more biodiversity in the city. And it also acts as a stormwater reservoir to reduce the amount of water we're dumping into our sewer system. On the urban wild front, there have been like 180 bird species now seen. This is about the fourth year and cataloged. And so the whole project has become a new thing for the zoo, and they started an urban wildlife institute to study wildlife in cities. So there's a colony of black-crowned night herons there. We had designed the underside of the bridge so it could be a ledge for cliff swallows, which they have taken up. And now they're using bioacoustics to study bats and the sounds in the environment. And so this is a picture of who visits the place at night. We have skunks and coyotes. But so it's very interesting to see how this biodiverse nature can intersect with the city. And then there's the pavilion. So really thinking outside of just the pavilion, but the pavilion itself is really interesting, made of these bent wood laminated lamellas that are come together almost like this woven structure. And it's very flexible, and it's really for outdoor education, but it started to be used for yoga and other things like weddings. Like all the architects like to get married there. But it's when you go to this place, you can't believe you're in the city. It's right in the middle of the city, and it's so incredibly full and vibrant. Some things happened there that we'd never planned for, like this was Dîner en Blanc, which was organized, self-organized to take place around the boardwalk. And so I think that's a good example of thinking about the relationship between people themselves and also their environment. One project that addresses relationships is the Polis Station. And this was really, it's an idea about, you know, based on all of the tension between police and community members going on today around the country, it was an attempt to think about a kind of a more community-centered police station. A lot of people think of police stations as fortresses, and in certain neighborhoods, kids are scared to go anywhere near the police station, you know, even to report a crime. And so it started out as a research project to think about the history of police stations. Maybe the architecture could do something to help this relationship. It's interesting because police stations actually started out just as call boxes, where the police would go there to meet at preordained times. But they were part of the community, and they would just tour around their own neighborhood. But with time, you know, and the automobile, police started living further away from the neighborhoods, and the station became surrounded by parking. In Chicago, about 15 years ago, they started a program to develop prototypes for these police stations. But they didn't really, you know, ask people what they wanted in their neighborhood. So we started thinking about how could the police station connect to some of these policy ideas about 21st century community policing to build the idea of trust between the groups. In order to do that, we set up a meeting between the police themselves in the North Lawndale neighborhood and the community members, and literally just asked them what they thought would be a good solution to make the police station more of a community space. And they came up with some pretty amazing ideas, like there should be a barbershop there. There could be a computer station. On the public side of the station, maybe it would be a place where you could get more community services. And they also noticed that during this meeting that the police really would like to be coaches of sports teams, but they don't really have a connection to do that. And the kids in the neighborhood thought it would be great to have basketball courts at this police station. So that idea kind of came out front, and we were able to raise funds, private funds, to install a half court as a small step on the police station parking lot in North Lawndale. So what's really amazing, we went back a year later and we found that the parents who were formerly afraid to have their kids go anywhere near the station now feel that this basketball court is safer than other ones nearby. And the police even started having basketballs inside that the kids can borrow. So at least starting to create some relationships to build trust. And so in the future, maybe this could be a future police station where you could have a birthday party or go to the barbershop or renew your driver's license. And then I wanted to show just a couple more quick projects that have to do with community. This is the Writers Theater project in Glencoe, Illinois. This was designed for a small theater, a theater company that was kind of world-renowned, but they were operating out of the back of a bookstore in Glencoe. And one of the things they noticed was that the people who came to the theater really were being challenged by the content, and they were really doing a lot of very interesting cultural content, but there was no place to go afterwards to continue that conversation. We looked back at histories and was really interested in theaters before there were theater buildings and where theater was more of a public space happening in the street or happening in some of these open courtyards. In Shakespeare's time, they used to happen in these inns. And so we thought that in addition to designing the actual rooms, which are somewhat dark, where the theater happens, maybe the lobby could be something more like this space, more of a civic space where they could have after-show talks and there could be all kinds of things taking place in this space, but it's actually just a lobby. And so it turned out really amazing that people are using it. There's kind of these large openings that connect it to the garden outside, and it can really, students have started using it after school to study and things like that. There's rehearsal space, the main thrust stage, but there's this walkway around the lobby that really connects people to the town of Glencoe and what's going on inside and really connects it back to the street. So it really is starting to develop a kind of over the first year that it's been there, a kind of civic nature, which is something that we really had hoped and dreamed for. I just wanted to mention some geeky architecture stuff about it because the walkway I was talking about is made out of wood, and it's using wood in tension, which wasn't allowed in the building codes, but we were able to mock this up. This is a test rig pulling apart the wood until failure to demonstrate its strength. So I'm really interested in how material also connects people to architecture. And so these are some of the connections. We called it a cat's paw that actually hold up the walkway that you can experience and go around. So it's almost like this canopy walk circling the building. And really thinking about when people see the building, they see this. They see that. I think people perceive the structural aspects as well. And then finally, we're currently working on an addition to this historic building. It's the American Museum of Natural History in New York. And we're adding a new wing for education and innovation in New York. And one of the things that really drew me to this project, besides, I guess, my love of nature, was the idea that science education is really being threatened today in the country. And one of the biggest roles of the museum is education. They also really want to make these cross-disciplinary collaborations between the scientists. They actually offer PhD degrees here at the museum. And one of the things we discovered, though, what I think is really interesting is in this small room in some remote part of the museum, there was this machine that everybody wanted to use, and it's a CT scanner. And Paula knows about it. Exactly. But it was such an incredible thing because all the different scientists of different disciplines were lining up outside this room to use the machine, and so they're scanning everything from pottery to skeletons, and it's almost like a mechanism for creating cross-disciplinarity, and you can see some of the scans here. So we captured that idea, and we're planning space for lounge space for scientists outside this equipment room. We realized that the museum is a place where you can really get lost, if anyone's ever been there. But kind of like deconstructing the museum, we found that there was actually order to it, and there's actually a center to it. So our design is also kind of about clarifying the circulation through the museum on this east-west axis, which is aligned with what they call Manhattan Henge, which is the sunset on two times of the year that goes down the axis of the streets. And so our atrium in the building will be aligned with that. We also wanted to promote this enthusiasm and excitement about discovery that, you know, personally I feel when I go hiking, like in places like Aspen and canyons, and the sense of discovery and making science really exciting to people. To study this as an architectural form, we used ice blocks and melted the ice blocks. It's a very analog way. Of course, we're working in digital technology too, but sometimes I just like making stuff, and we just took, it was freezing cold winter in Chicago. We took this big ice blocks out and started with a little blowtorch and started to melt them out. And so you can see on the left the ice melted shape and then some of the 3D model prints that we started to make. And trying to figure out how to do this as an architecture. This is a wooden model, and here's some images of where it is today in terms, we're still in design, but through this architectural space that's on axis with the 79th Street corridor. And that's what it will look like from the outside.
Fantastic.
And then I just wanted to mention that I was lucky enough to be able to work with Paula directly and design her space for her studio work in Chicago. And I think with that project, we really collaborated closely and realized that the thing that needed to be pushed on there was making art making a healthier activity. It's notoriously bad for the health, using lots of chemicals and things like that. So that was our focus here, and we really improved the air quality, all the materials inside. You can see there's a lot of these arms that come down that extract those bad air outside. And this is a picture of the intellectual hub of the space in the library. So with that, maybe we can just start our conversation.
Great. Well, thank you, Jeanie. So the thing that we connected on with regard to the studio was the environment. So all the materials are sustainable. Mm-hmm. The fact that the library was in the center of the place, and then also having a clean space for artists, which is not mm-hmm. something that's usually advocated for. And as a point of real pride, we did get a LEED Gold rating yes. for the studio, which is pretty amazing for a place that works with toxic materials. Mm-hmm. So, Jeanne, let's start with the creative process and how a project unfolds. Do you find yourself responding to a particular site, obviously to the client, or to the purpose of the building?
You know, when we start a project, it's really important to us to have a little research phase in the project to understand how to situate that project. And usually I try to advocate for, you know, a research phase, you know, that's actually part of the process. But sometimes it has to go simultaneously along with the design process. But what we're doing in that research phase is looking in many different directions, like looking at how the building, what the site is, what the climate is, who the users are, what other significant architecture is nearby, what's missing. You know, that's another thing, like what's missing in this context. So it really is trying to look at it as a whole environment first. And then sometimes you're surprised that some piece of research rises up to the top that you didn't even expect. So I think it's really important in design to allow for this playtime, kind of free experience in the beginning. And then what we do in our studios, we all come back together and share that research, and usually some important things rise to the top. And then, though, you have to turn it off and just start making things. That's a really important part about creativity is to actually either drawing or making or modeling. And you know, all the time this information is in the back of your head. So when you're making things, it's more informed somehow. But you have to let loose and create as well.
So it reminds me of talking to Maya Lin about doing a commission and doing a mock-up. And she said, you know, I don't do those anymore. I take on a project and then I go fishing, figuratively, maybe literally. But it sounds like that's so much part of the project, is you get to know the environment and you get to know the purpose and the materials.
Yeah, and the purpose of it really is to help the client who came to you, the person who is trying to do a building. Like, I'm really attracted to projects where the organization is trying to reinvent themselves or to do something the first time. And they know that their current building might be getting in their way, but they don't really know what the next thing is going to be yet. And so it's also a time of a lot of sharing with the client, the things that they've been thinking about. And oftentimes we create a bibliography for each project. So it's like, you know, it's very intellectual, but what I like about the bibliography is it keeps getting added to, and then when new people start coming onto the team, they can always get up to speed with what the intellectual background of the project.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about point of view. Do you feel that you come into a project just as part of the way you see the world, with a point of view in terms of an aerial view, human perspective, and we've seen in your work even a worm's eye view.
Yeah.
Is that something that is malleable, or it's something that you have a tendency towards?
Oh, yeah, I think it's the experience. My first thing, I guess, is really thinking about the experience, maybe almost on like a choreographic idea about how people arrive, move through, and use the different spaces. But in doing that exercise, it is really important to get into other people's shoes in a way and walk through. Imagine how different people are going to be impacted by and, you know, benefit from the building. So if we're doing a tall building, we're thinking about the people who live there, the people who are using it, but we're also thinking about just a pedestrian walking down the street and their experience of what it might be.
So that way of thinking, of projecting yourself in the space, is that something that you always did that comes naturally to you?
I guess I didn't know that other people didn't do that. So, yeah, I guess so. And maybe that is... really, there is a narrative quality to it that is, it's a story that you're trying to construct in your mind of how this building will unfold and what the potential of it has to be.
Mm-hmm. Well, you are a multi-hyphenate and take on so many roles. And your latest one is that you're a specialist in relationships. You can see that with some of your projects, with many of your projects, you need to understand and balance those relationships. Mm. And I was particularly touched by the work that you did at the police station. Mm. How do you research that? How do you take that on?
Yeah.
Because that's quite a challenge as well.
Yeah, that's a great question, because some projects in our practice, there are projects that have clients and then there's kind of independent research projects. And that one started that way. We happened to be designing a firehouse, like a fire rescue building in Brooklyn. And I got to spend a day with the fire rescue workers, which was really fun. but what I noticed, though, there was they had a very strong relationship with the community around them and with each other. And then when you read the reports on police, you see the task force study, you see that the relationship obviously with community is stressed, but also even with each other, there's a lot of times police only have one partner. They don't have a group that they don't have support within. So there was some very interesting differences between the two, and so, you know, it was just, I started thinking about if the actual space and the environment could help to add something to this problem and this dialogue and try to move it forward in terms of the environment. And so with that project, because there wasn't really a client, we reached out to people that we knew to try to just have the first conversation about it. And we were able to organize this meeting with both the police in North Lawndale and the community members, and with very specific questions that were to be addressed. It was called a community cafe, and it was interesting because once you started talking about design, it did work to diffuse some of the tensions that were in the room, because everybody thinks about their space and the potential of it. And so that's how we started gathering information on that project. And then it really just seemed like there was a very easy solution to get done right away, which was to turn some of this extra parking into a basketball court that could be used. And now, though, they've come back to us and we're working on expanding it, because they only had a half court, now they want it more. and then the police want to have a space outside that can also be used for cookouts and things. So it's like they're coming out of the station. So it's really encouraging, even if it's a small step.
That's great. You've totally changed the model. That's just brilliant. So let's talk about some of our favorite things. let's talk about materials and how they drive your design and your vision.
A lot of times, materials are... I ended up studying. I was at the ETH, which is for a fellowship in Switzerland, and it's a very similar setup as the Bauhaus, where the studios are taught through the material. So like you have a wood studio, a masonry studio, concrete. And then my first teaching job in the States, I was working at IIT and teaching, and which is a very similar way of teaching. So it really became kind of habit to understand the material first. When we were designing the Aqua Tower in Chicago, we already knew it was going to be concrete building. Our client, Jim Loewenberg, was like, it's going to be concrete. So it was great. You start with that. And then pull out the qualities of that material. It's fluid. It can be define a curve. It is very different than working with steel. And so I'm always trying to find what the qualities of the material are. And lately, even more, I've been really interested in how materials connect to specific histories. We were working on a project recently where we discovered that the traditional buildings in this place, which look like masonry simply, were actually built with ballast from slave ships. And it was really just, to me, just a shock of a material that's connected to such a bad and difficult history. And so, like, now more and more, I'm also thinking about the import of those histories with the materials. Whether if you're thinking about a building in Chicago that's made out of steel, the impact on material is really all the way up into Minnesota, where the forests are, or where the coal came from. So every building is really, in a way, it speaks to a much larger environment. So I've been expanding the way I think about materials. And I know I want to ask you something, too, because I noticed that with your work, you're really into how the materials appear, but then what they actually do, like the broken materials and how they can be interpreted. So maybe you can add to this dialogue.
So oftentimes the work comes out of the process and getting to know the materials, and then the materials very much speak as to how they should be manifested. Mm-hmm. So I love the model that you were talking about, Bauhaus-based. But I think we need to focus on the materials and see what it's telling us. Mm-hmm. And Michelangelo used to say, I look at a block and then the sculpture comes out of that. So that speaks to the power of observation and certainly our willingness to invest and immerse in these materials.
And they also, when you're doing architecture, of course, we model it digitally, which is kind of immaterial in some ways. So oftentimes we'll try to physically model architecture designs with a material that might be similar to the real material that we're going to use. So with a concrete building, we might try casting plaster. Or with a wood building, we might try using, you know, cardboard, but wetting it and getting it to bend and things like that. So I think that simulation of, you know, the qualities is also really important, even when you're scaling it down to, you know, a smaller model. But
If people do have a chance, I hope they'll visit your studio. It is so exciting to see all the models and the simulations. Do you want to just spend a minute on how you engage technology and looking at wind and light and the solar carving of the building that you're doing in New York?
Okay. Yeah, this is, I think our biggest advantage with technology now is the information that we can get from it. So, you know, a lot in the first round, a lot of architects focused on the tools and the, let's say, the fabrication elements, and that is, it has transformed and it's incredible, but there's this deeper thing, which is how much information you can get from these digital models. So the project you mentioned, we use the sun angles to carve a shape of the building that would preserve more light to the environment around it, which is located on the High Line in New York. So we were trying to preserve light onto a garden that was along the High Line. And you know, this is all pretty easy to do with digital materials. But also, I think with the information aspect, when we've started our urban practice over the last 4 years, working in places like Memphis and Southwest Philly, and we've really expanded that part of our practice, we're using information to help us connect to people that are stakeholders in communities. We're using things like things that people enter into social media about their spaces, and we're able to gather that kind of information. So it's really giving us a much better view of the place where we're going to be designing something, a more holistic view. It doesn't replace meeting one-on-one with people, but you can kind of survey something very much more broadly now than it was in the past.
Very interesting. Yeah. Tell me, we share interest in the role of being activist with our practices. Do you you feel it's essential for architects today to be addressing these larger environments, our environment, alternative facts with the science pavilion? Can you comment a bit about how you undertake that role and how that is in context of the larger profession?
Yeah, I guess I never think of myself, I'd like to think of our practice as advocates instead of activists, because we're usually trying to find something that is working and then like boost it or amp it up. And so we use the word advocacy, and that kind of encompasses our approach to many of the things that we're, you know, interested in solving, especially in inner cities. One of the issues in a lot of the cities in the middle of the country, the ones I was mentioning, the cities are shrinking. So it's a very different problem than we see in let's say Asia, where cities are, the population is really growing. So we're usually trying to find ways to knit those together and make them more vibrant. I don't know how, this is just the way that I use architecture as a medium, and I think you use art as a medium to just to be in the world and to use it as an instrument to have something to say, something to offer, something to give back. And that's just the way that we practice. And I've been lucky to find a lot of people who think like that as well. So my team is, you know, pretty big team now. We have about 80 in Chicago and 20 in New York, one in San Francisco, and we found each other, you know, and we really are all interested in how architecture can build on things that could use some help.
Well, I know with your design, and I know with my work, we want to present moments of pause, and to get people to stop and reflect. And your projects certainly do that visually and experientially. If I can ask one more question, then we'll open up to the audience. What's your dream project? It's an easy one.
Yeah. I feel like I'm doing my dream projects right now, but I've always more and more seeing how culture is playing a very strong role in making stronger relationships, working with communities. So we've been working on theaters. I'd really like to get more into the visual arts through art spaces and museums, but kind of, you know, thinking about what that could be, what could be the next museum, and how could it be more engaging and outward focused, maybe. I think those are some thoughts that I'm having. I'm still really interested in tall buildings because I think they're kind of like, you know, the DNA of a city. You want people to live in the city, and so tall buildings and just residential buildings in general, I feel like there can be a lot of improvement there to make it more compelling for people to want to live in the cities. And I'm always interested in crossing natural environments with urban environments, and like the Lincoln Park Zoo Nature Boardwalk, seeing how can we make that intersection work? There's definitely going to be conflicts, to be sure, but because cities are growing in footprint, not necessarily in population in this country, but you know, it becomes harder and harder to make these connective corridors to maintain biodiversity. So I think that we have to do it right through the middle of the city, and we're starting to see how that what that looks like.
Oh, wonderful, thank you. if we could ask the audience if you would like to ask some questions. Mm-hmm. I think we have a microphone that will help with the sound.
Yes, hello, good afternoon. My name is Mandy Mahoney. I work in the Deep South, where cities are shrinking. And it's great to hear you talk about it because we don't often in this country. Can you say more about, you said knitting cities back together.
Yeah.
Can you just speak to that more?
Yes, sure. No, it's really interesting because I go to a lot of international venues for architects, and so much of the conversation is about, you know, the density and exploding fastly growing cities, but it's really true in our country. There's neighborhoods are there's blight and there's deterioration, and so we've been working with the Knight Foundation and Kresge Foundation on Civic Commons, which is a project that it takes almost the process that we used on the Polis station to identify what these what people want in their city or their neighborhood, and then identify what the assets are that already are working. And those could be hard assets, like let's say a public library that's already there, or they could be soft assets, like a very effective community group. And so like in Southwest Philly, we really tried to look at that whole context and connect dots between the things that were working well. And so we came up with, it was based on, there were already a lot of studies done there, but we went in and produced a plan of action of what, like kind of a prioritization that the city could do. They have some funds coming from the, I think it's the sugary beverage tax or something, and they have to decide what they want to do. So we helped them to prioritize what were the assets that were really working, and what could they do to marry those things together with community groups that are active. I think a lot of times, and one important point is to go through the scale of architecture. You know, because we think about urban planning, and it's always been the really zoomed out view, but it's hard to relate to. And so what I've found is, like, if you can identify a building that, you know, that can transform and do some of these things, that can act really quickly. And so, for an example, in Southwest Philly, we found that there was a rec center that was pretty dilapidated and kind of scary, and you know, it was, but it had like good bones. And then there was some groups that were doing health services through a traveling a van throughout the neighborhood. So we thought of just taking the rec center and transforming it into more of a wellness center. So it does have recreation, but then it also gets this added wellness factor. And to even think of, we found out that most people these days get their glasses and eye prescriptions and things through retail outlets, as opposed to going to doctors, and as well as the other thing was like rehab. So we even proposed that there could be some retail spaces that provide these kinds of co-locating some spaces that people ordinarily use with government programs, with the rec center as the bones. And so it's really about trying to marry these things together. And that's why, in a way, to me, it always comes back to, it's very parallel to looking at ecology. What's the environment? What are these different things that work together?
Biodiversity and all the relationships.
Yeah,
exactly. It's wonderful to see your practice focus on that. Another question?
Hi. Is that on? Can you hear me? Yeah. Hi, James Edwards. You talked quite a bit about how you derive inspiration from nature, especially in terms of materials and forms. I wonder if you could expand a little bit on how you derive inspiration from nature in terms of designing systems or even energy flows, and that could be flows of people, but in the boathouse, you talked about your passive heating and cooling system. So
yes.
I'd like to hear a little bit about that, please.
That's really great, because today there's so many different approaches that one can take to reducing carbon footprint, reducing energy footprint. And so similarly to making these other things work together, we're usually trying to find the right fit between what works with the project use and the available assets, if it's a sunny climate or if it's someplace where that has access to water, and trying to merge those together to come up with the solution for the particular project that will, be the system solution. And it's so fascinating, and it's in a totally specific to each project. For example, in one project that we recently completed at the University of Chicago is a residence hall with 800 beds. And so the thing that's most in demand is hot water. And so thinking about how to address that need. Our first approach is always reducing the use through passive means, like how you site the building and how you insulate the building. So you reduce the demand down as much as you can first, before going into the active systems, like using PV, but in that case, like solar hot water, which really helps reduce a direct need that the building has. So, it's very important to work with creative engineers that are really interested in the same thing. So we have a cadre of creative engineers that we always are their go-to engineers for. Sustainability, and it's also really important to start that conversation in the very, very beginning of the project, and then that solution merges very well with the architectural solution. It's a great point, and it I think ultimately I like that the systems are somewhat invisible, and they are they're becoming more and more invisible. Instead of showing off, like, here's my wind turbine, here's my PV cells in front. But I think it more than that, it's the whole approach to it that has to be integrated. So,
another question?
Hi, Linda Munger here. I will say, as a daughter of a Chicago architect, I so appreciate what you're doing there in Chicago in particular. My question is this: do you ever do private residences? And if so, what is your ideal project? But if not, and you were forced to, what would be your ideal project?
Forced me, okay. the answer, yes. I have done private residences, and I am really happy to do that, especially with people that I already like and know. Or, but you know, I haven't really. We don't do lots of them at the same time. It's kind of like one or two at the most. That because it's like intense. You know, it's someone's home, so it really is. The relationship there is between, you know, the architect and the person who's going to live in that home. And usually for me, it's friends or, you know, people who are like-minded that I want to work with. And it is what I love about it is getting into the detail of the touchable scale of architecture, and the materials again become really important. So yeah, I think I would love to do something in an environment where there is a strong goal to be very sustainable and in a beautiful environment, like Aspen, for example. but it's a conscious decision not to do too many at the same time, because it is, you know, it's a personal commitment as well for me, and but it's very enjoyable.
Oh, well, the microphone's coming.
Okay.
Tying all those threads among all your projects is really quite extraordinary. Yeah. You've got tallest towers and these intimate spaces.
It's true. It turns out, and I'm so interested in all those scales. And I found with my team, some people migrate to different, you know, like some people really love working out the tall buildings, and other people are much more on different scales. So that's kind of a self-selection process, but I'm lucky I get to address all the scales.
That's great.
Great. Could you please talk a follow-up again on your comments about tall buildings and how you're imagining that? And the second thing is, as a tool of high tall buildings, the idea of affordable housing and how they come together as you think down the road. Thank you.
Yeah, I think, obviously with a city, it's better to have in our city, let's narrow it down to North America cities, a denser urban environment where people can live and work in closer proximity. Because if you look at the carbon footprint of a person who lives in an urban, like a dense city center versus like a suburban environment, which is also considered urban, by the way, but if you just compare the two, the household carbon footprint is about 7 times higher in the suburban environment. So that's already like a charge for us to make the urban environments and urban dwellings more compelling and more, attract people to move downtown and to want to be in the space. And then it brings up issues about, you know, how do you still maintain privacy, but also have this denser fabric? Affordable housing, I think one of the most progressive projects that I've been working on recently is a tower in San Francisco on Folsom Street. And, I can't really take any credit for the mix that is there, but it was already determined before we joined the project to have a very large part of that be affordable housing. And so mixing very, you know, high-end market rate housing with affordable housing in the same block. And I think San Francisco is probably, you know, one of the cities that's the most advanced when it comes to thinking through this, and there's such a need for housing there. What we did do, though, was propose to the city to add more affordable housing if we made the building taller, because there was a little bit of a resistance to going higher there. We already had a 300-foot high building. It could easily be 400 feet, you know, and there's buildings around it that are already 400 feet. So that was our contribution, and kind of the developers decided to push for that, and it was actually welcomed by the city because there's such a demand for high. But I think, what I like about the approach there is there's not two different entries. People use the same lobbies. The quality is quite good on both the high rise and the low rise part of the building. But I guess you could say it's easier to do there because there is such demand in it, and you know, it's easier to just raise the price of the market rate units in order to help pay for that. So I think it's something that the mix is really interesting. It should be looked at further in other cities, I think, as well. And then, yeah, like making it pencil out for the developer is really the hardest part. So.
Robin, did you have a question?
Well, going back to the high-rise aspect, and one of the important things I do think is really discussing carbon footprint, which I know you've addressed. Mm-hmm. But the one thing I did want to have you talk a little bit about is how, you know, it's really obvious in the small projects that you do, there are these little jewels. Mm-hmm. They really, the brick house or the brick weave house or the things that you've done that really have been about a material. Mm-hmm. And how you translate that mm-hmm. to a high rise mm-hmm. and bringing in nature. You started to hit on it a little bit, but I just think that yeah. that's a very interesting story. Mm-hmm. If you could elaborate a little bit.
Yeah. That's a great question because, again, there's, you know, there's limited materials that you can use on a high rise, you know, and thankfully fire resistant materials that we have, you know, basically we've got concrete, you know, glass and cladding materials that are suited for that kind of building. So I think it's really more about, you know, with starting a tall building, it's there's a couple of different trajectories that we think about. One is like how that building is going to meet the ground, because a lot of times people don't even know how tall the building is that are walking down the street. Their really only experience with it is at that ground level. So like at the Vista Tower that we're currently designing in Chicago, there's actually a public pass-through in the building that was, it was part of the planning, but it's really emphasized in our design, which uses two outside buildings to kind of support the inside one, so people can actually go through the building on two different levels at grade. And so I think that's a big contribution to high-rise design. I hope other people copy it and do it, because it makes the building less of a fortress to walk all the way around in such a big building. And then I think oftentimes we start with the inside and move to the outside. So like with the Vista Tower, thinking about corners and creating more corners so you get different light coming in from different exposures, as opposed to you know, kind of a unit that would be more tunnel-like and just getting the one exposure. And so that starts to, then we look for oftentimes in nature things that are analogous to faceted cornered things, and we usually try to, because there's always something to learn from nature, and so we'll try to find models in nature that are doing something similar, and then that ends up informing the process and moving it even further forward. So I think there's different scales of material study, there are different scales of the parts of the tower. It's really important for tall buildings to have this human scale, which sounds like a little bit like a cliche for architects because everyone says that, but you know, in our work, we really are breaking down the scale to a more elemental scale. Like at the Aqua Tower, it's done with slabs that you can see each level, and then there's an overall shape. In the Vista Tower, we're working with these modules and adding them up so people can relate to the building. And I think that's one of the biggest challenges in high-rise design.
Jeanne, thank you so much for this morning. And
thank you.
We look forward to having you back in many ways. So we'll put our thinking caps on.
Thank you.